Welcome back. Pakistan continues to provoke, even with India and Pakistan all set to hold bilateral talks today. A BSF jawan was killed in cross-border firing just last night.
Just hours before Prime Minister Narendra Modi meets his Pakistani counterpart for their first bilateral meeting in a year, there's been a fresh provocation on the line of control.
On the eve of Indo-Pak Prime Minister's meet, Pakistani guns blaze again. This time around in the Baramulla sector of line of control, Pakistani army targeting the Karam post, a post jointly manned by the BSF and the Indian army. In this fresh incident of sniper firing, the BSF has lost a jawan of the 119 battalion.
Is it of concern to you that right on the eve of our talks, a jawan has been killed in North Kashmir today, a BSF jawan?
Look, we are fully aware of what is happening and we are fully capable of dealing with any situation. The meeting tomorrow is in a different context and I think let us leave it at that.
The latest provocation by Pakistan comes just 3 days after its army fired on the Indian post in the Naugam sector, killing a BSF jawan. And now again there's been a fresh incident of unprovoked firing.
Pakistan seems to have become emboldened over the last few weeks, and I would link this actually with the support given to Pakistan by China at the United Nations Security Council in relation to Lakhvi.
The world community will draw its own conclusions about why a BSF jawan was killed today. The link with the meeting is quite clear.
But now it's for the Prime Minister to ensure that India sets the agenda for Pakistan, especially on issues like cross-border violation and terror. With Fareed in Srinagar, Sriyashi Dev for Times Now.
Reactions have come in from the kin of the BSF jawan who was martyred in the cross-border firing, even as the wreath-laying ceremony is on. Take a listen to what the family have to say.
पहले तो ये खबर आई कि आपके भाई को गोली लगी है. कुछ देर बाद फिर सूचना आई गई कि उन्हें बाएं आंख में गोली लग के पार हो गई.
नवाज शरीफ से भारत के प्रधानमंत्री की मुलाकात है, क्या कहोगे इस पे?
पाकिस्तान कभी सुधरने वाला है नहीं. मुलाकात करने से कोई फायदा नहीं है. उसे एक ही बार खत्म करो या फिर बढ़िया से बात करो. मैंने भी भरा है, मेरे मन में भी काफी आक्रोश है.
प्रधानमंत्री को मिलना चाहिए. एक तरफ वार्ता हो रही है, दूसरी तरफ पाकिस्तान गोली चला रहा है.
वार्ता करे लेकिन कड़ा रुख अपना के, नरम मी से बात ना करे उससे.
Schedule for the Prime Minister.
All right. In fact, in just about a while from now, we are going to have the bilateral meeting between Mr. Nawaz Sharif and Mr. Narendra Modi starting. After that, there is a meeting that Mr. Modi has scheduled with Mr. Ghani, the president of Afghanistan. And before that, in between the two of them, of course, we are going to have a briefing by both the Indian and the Pakistani side about the outcome of this bilateral meeting right here. This is the hotel where the Pakistani delegation is staying. And of course, in just a while from now, we are going to see Mr. Nawaz Sharif and his advisor, Mr. Sartaj Aziz, leaving for the bilateral meet. It's a matter of only a few minutes the delegation is now going to leave from this hotel, and they're going to go to Congress Hall from here, where that bilateral meeting is going to take place in another 15 to 20 minutes from now. That meeting is due to start.
Well, Padmaja, we continue to have Bharat Karnad and Brigadier V. Mahalingam with us, and we played out in terms of what the family and the kith and kin want of the BSF jawan who was martyred. And Bharat Karnad, that's the sentiment we were talking about before we went into the break, that there is a commitment with this government made to the people. So if you say that foreign policy cannot be equated with has to be with public sentiment.
Stay the frame, Kera.
There has to be a difference. And Padmaja, is there something happening behind you? You seem a little distracted. Have people started coming into where the talks are going to happen?
Yes. Yes, in fact, like I mentioned, Anand, in just a while from now, we are going to have the Pakistani side leaving, the Pakistani Prime Minister, Mr. Nawaz Sharif. This is the place where he is, in fact, staying. And the entire delegation, in fact, is staying over here. So we are expecting him to leave in just a couple of minutes, because it's just 20 minutes left for the bilateral meeting to start. And the Indian side, we're also learning, is just going to leave from its hotel. And that's when the Pakistani side will also leave from here. Of course, the actual meeting venue is just about a couple of minutes away. But but we are expecting the delegation to leave any moment now. We see several officials, the deputy chief of mission here in Russia already outside. So we're just waiting for the Pakistani Prime Minister to step out.
Well, staying with you, Padmaja, and are we expecting a briefing? Are we expecting a joint briefing? And any comments before the meet starts? Like Nawaz Sharif yesterday said, we let us talk and then I'll talk. So is that what is going to be the stated position from Pakistan all along?
Well, the Indian side has already said that our briefing is going to be 45 minutes after the bilateral start. So 9:15 local time is when the meeting is supposed to start. 10 a.m. local time is when the Indian side is going to have its briefing. That is already scheduled. The Pakistani side, though, has not really announced when they plan to have a briefing, if at all. They've said that they are going to speak. The Prime Minister yesterday told us, the Pakistani Prime Minister, that is, that let the meeting get over. But and it's only after that that we'll talk. So perhaps they're going to wait for the Indian side to come out and make their statement, and after that they are going to come out with their own statement.
Well, so you're going to have a tough job right now, Padmaja, because you are going to be engaging in this discussion with Mr. Karnad and Brigadier Mahalingam while keeping an eye behind you as the delegation is stepping out. But we will stay with the pictures coming in with Padmaja, because there seems to be some movement happening behind you, Padmaja, as we also bring in Mr. Karnad. Sir, your point of view here, do you believe that there needs to be another entity sitting at the table when India engages with Pakistan?
Maybe not at the table, but there has to be an independent link-up and dialogue perhaps between the two army chiefs. Are very unequal, of course. You have Rohil Sharif in Pakistan, who is the dominant force, and the Indian army chief, who really is on the margins. But it's a symbolic dialogue, I think, that's very important, to connect the militaries and get them talking to each other. Because it's precisely the tactical situations you talk about result in deaths and other kinds of hostile occurrences every now and then. And that needs to be stopped. And that can happen when the army chiefs talk to each other. And I think that should be pursued. This is what I've been saying for the last 30 years. And that unless you have the armies talking to each other, there's not going to be the kind of deportment of the two forces on the border that's peaceful and that ensures that there's no, even though it's a ceasefire line and it's a live fire situation, to minimize casualties and to minimize frictions. And I think that's the thing that can be achieved when the two army chiefs meet. Should they meet? And I think they should meet. That's the way to go. Because you keep the most dominant player in Pakistan out of the formal loop. And as you have said, you have Nawaz Sharif and the government of Pakistan, the civilian government, which is a creature of the Pakistan army. Mm. And that's the way their polity has developed. It's not a value judgment. Similarly, in our situation, it's just the other way around. The political forces are the dominant element. And so we have to take care to ensure that there's dialogue at all levels that goes on, and especially between the highest in the political apex level and the highest in the military at the apex level. That would really help, I think.
Brigadier Mahalingam, your thoughts, and what we'll do is we'll also, I'm sure Padmaja is listening into this discussion because she has made her way inside into the lobby area where we'll try and get first visuals of Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif along with his delegation making his way out. Yes, Brigadier Mahalingam, do you concur with Bharat Karnad there?
I'm absolutely in agreement with what Mr. Karnad said, that the Pakistan army cannot be on the high table. Now, having said that, let me say a few things. One is, this particular talk has got a very significant message being sent to the entire world. That is, a democratically elected Prime Minister of India talking to a democratically elected Prime Minister of Pakistan, knowing fully well that the Prime Minister's Pakistan's powers have been usurped by the Pakistan army. And the fact that India is not putting or directly talking to the Pakistani army chief at the political level must send a very clear message to the entire world that the way India looks at democracy totally in all aspects. Now, having said that, Now as far as army is concerned, I think there is an absolute need for the Indian army chief to go and have a dialogue with the army chief of Pakistan on a one-to-one basis, because the military minds and military thoughts do understand loss of blood and loss of soldiers. And I'm sure, if not anything at all, at least to some extent, the border issue, the ceasefire violations can take some sort of a break, if not throughout, at least for some time.
Well, let's hope that that is something which is achieved. A reaction coming in from the Congress. Let's take a listen to what Manish Tiwari has to say as we stay with these pictures. We are expecting Nawaz Sharif to walk out any moment now.
The fundamental question is, why is this meeting at all taking place? It is an exercise in futility. It is void ab initio. It is nothing more than a photo opportunity. These are the same people who for 10 years said that terror and talks cannot go hand in hand. These are the same guys who called off the talks because the Pakistanis or the Pakistani High Commissioner spoke to the Hurriyat. What has really changed? There was a breach across the LOC. Last night, a BSF Jawan has been killed. So this meeting is absolutely an unprecedented disaster. There is nothing to it. And you mark my words, you can start running it now, that the moment the meeting is over, every television will say, that it, channel will say it's an exercise in futility.
So the Congress calling it already an exercise in futility and taking pot shots, not shirking away from taking a snipe at the NDA government. And the fact is, it was the Prime Minister himself, before he became Prime Minister, who said that terror and talks cannot go together, they cannot go hand in hand. And that's exactly what is happening right now. So how much of a come down is it by India, and what will India take away in terms of positives post this 15-minute meet? That's very, very important. I'm just going to check if we can speak to Padmaja. Padmaja, can you talk to... Yes, can you take us through what's happening inside? Because we feel it looks like they are a little behind schedule.
Yes. Yes, that seems like it, because we already have the PRO to the Prime Minister and the Deputy Chief of Mission over here in Russia. They're all here in the lobby of the hotel waiting. And in just a while from now, we're expecting, of course, right here you can also see the vehicle of the Prime Minister has already been parked outside. So they're just all waiting for him. Slightly behind schedule is what we are learning right now. So in a couple of minutes is when we should expect the Pakistani Prime Minister to step out, because like we mentioned, the meeting is supposed to begin in less than 5 minutes from now, Anand. But this really is from where the Pakistani Prime Minister and his advisor are going to be exiting in just a few minutes from now.
So it's just a walk across the meeting area, the meeting point, not very far away from where Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif is. So is the Pakistani part and the Prime Minister and the Pakistani delegation waiting for the Indian Prime Minister to move out so that they can time it in such a way that neither arrives before the other? They both arrive simultaneously, because that's also a big statement they make in terms of diplomatically.
Actually, in fact, just a while ago when we spoke to the Pakistani officials, they said that your side is going to leave, and then that's when we are also going to step out. So I think that we are seeing some of the senior officials from Pakistan now come. There's Mr. Sartaj Aziz. We can see the advisor to the Prime Minister, Mr. Sartaj Aziz, now stepping out. Let's see if he says anything about the expectations that Pakistan has. The first image is there. So you can expect now that the Prime Minister also, in just a couple of minutes, is going to be coming out. They were waiting for the Indian delegation to leave their hotel. It's slightly farther off from the Pakistani hotel, so I believe the Indian delegation has already left, and now the Pakistani delegation ready to go as well. Sartaj Aziz here with us. Sir, one issue you would like to see addressed?
Inshallah. All the issues.
All right, so you first heard it, Sartaj Aziz saying that all the issues is what they want addressed. One issue he's not willing to name. He said all the issues we want spoken about today when Mr. Narendra Modi and Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif meet, not really giving much away. But yesterday he said, first let the talks happen. That's when we're going to start talking to you and tell you. Today, Sartaj Aziz saying all the issues are on the table. Back to you, Anand.
Well, we stay with you, Padmaja, because it's interesting the kind of the body language, the positivity which is being shown, and you talked about a confidence that Pakistan is exuding. Now, does that stem from the fact that they've got China's backing behind them, or the fact that it is India that's called for the meeting this time around? Because Sartaj Aziz is also walking out with a smile on his face and saying, inshallah, let's hope all the issues are addressed. In 15 minutes, one wonders how many issues will be addressed, but they are expecting that Pakistan will walk out taking out more positives out of this meeting. Is that safe to concur given the kind of attitude expressed by the Pakistani delegation so far?
Well, yesterday they did seem to be very confident yesterday as well, Anand. They did seem to be very confident yesterday, and remember they were at pains to underline the fact that it was the Indian side which approached them for talks. The overture was made by India. Now when we questioned the Indian side about it, the spokesperson of the MEA or the foreign secretary, they all said that it's not important which side sent the invitation, which side made that gesture, but what's important is that important issues, significant issues should be on the table. They should be spoken about, because if any progress has to be made, at least there have to be talks. A knee-jerk reaction of calling off all talks is not something that is sustainable. For any movement forward, at least both the sides have to come together and talk. If we want any resolution to the terror issue, the outstanding issues between India and Pakistan, at least a conversation is essential. I believe now that Mr. Nawaz Sharif is also out. Yes, you have that. The first image is there of Mr. Nawaz Sharif also coming out, and he's headed now on his way to the Congress Hall, where the meeting in a couple of minutes will take place. Mr. Sharif, one issue. All right, let's see if we can still...
Yes, we are with you, Padmaja. Go ahead and see if he reacts.
Nawaz Sahab, one issue, sir.
Well, we'll see if the pictures ease out, but this is just from a few seconds ago. Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif acknowledging Times Now there, and also, but not making any comment. Padmaja has just walked out along with our video journalist to try and see if the Prime Minister, Pakistan Prime Minister, is able to pinpoint one issue that they want addressed in this bilateral meet that will get underway in a few minutes from now. They are about 5 to 7 minutes behind schedule, but they should make up for the time. And one wonders whether this 15-minute slot that's been accorded by both the countries gets extended, because that will be a significant sign that there has been some engagement to some level. If this meeting goes on for about 20 to 25 minutes, whether or not the two leaders are able to strike a personal equation that then flows down and waters down into something more concrete in terms of the equations between the two countries, one has to wonder, one has to wait and watch. The other thing that we also need to say is, are these two nations going to approach this bilateral meet as cautiously as we are also viewing it? The Congress has already said that it's a futile effort. Let's take a listen to what Mr. Sartaj Aziz said when Padmaja asked him one issue that he would like to see addressed.
Sartaj Aziz here with us. Sir, one issue you would like to see addressed?
Inshallah. All the issues.
All right, so you first heard it, Sartaj Aziz saying that all the issues is what they want addressed.
So Pakistan is hoping for some positives to come out of it. Sartaj Aziz walking out and saying we'd like to see all issues being addressed. So that should be a very, very long chat between the two leaders if all issues have to be spoken up. But if there have been wheels within wheels, there have been engagements on the sidelines and back channel talks between the two delegations, then perhaps both parties, both nations are going to sit across the table, meet and greet, and then talk shop, and they would have a constructive set agenda. That is what one would want to see. Mr. Karnad, thank you for your patience. Brigadier Malingam, appreciate your patience, sir. Mr. Karnad, are you also expecting that both parties and both sides, at least this time in Russia and Ufa, be it 15 minutes, 20 minutes or 25, they sit with an agenda and they address issues which they believe can be resolved?
Well, I'm not sure that there's a set agenda. I think it's for the Prime Minister of India, who has initiated this meeting, to begin talking. I think Nawaz Sharif will pick up the cues from whatever Mr. Modi says. So that's what happens. I think then they'll go through their list of issues that both sides want to put forward. There's not going to be a resolution or anything of the kind. But as I said earlier in this program, there will be some kind of an agreement on a resumption of some formal medium of talks, which is going to be at the foreign secretary level, because it's unlikely to be at the level of the political apex. So I think it's a good sign. And I think, as I said, the most important thing again, the achievement will be the bond that they might, personal bond that the two prime ministers will develop.
No, I'm just, Mr. Karnad, sorry to interrupt you. We are just staying with the visuals coming in from Ufa and going across to Padmaja to understand. Padmaja, has the Indian Prime Minister already made his way? And is the Pakistan Prime Minister taking 2 minutes or 3 minutes into the meeting area a little later? So is there a statement being given there? And did he respond to your query as you followed him out?
Nothing at all, Ananda. In fact, nothing coming from the Prime Minister himself. I think the Pakistani Prime Minister is quite clear that till the time the talks happen, they do not want to make any comment on what is going to be on the table. But the Indian side has made it very clear that terror is one of the main talking points. The action, or rather the lack of action against Zakir Rehman Lakhvi, the fact that he's been allowed out of jail, that is something that India is going to bring up very strongly. The cross-border violations are going to be brought up very strongly, and the counter that Pakistan has to it is the Samjhota blast and the investigation into it. However, India is also clear that there can be no parity drawn between these two episodes.
I'm just talking about the live visuals that we can show to our viewers. Nawaz Sharif has walked into the meeting area. Prime Minister Narendra Modi was already waiting for him. The handshake was warm. He's also greeted Sartaj Aziz with equal warmth. There are smiles all across. Nawaz Sharif also walking across to speak to Ajit Doval, there we see, and other members of the Indian delegation who are also present there. So the handshakes going around all around. But what was significant is that Prime Minister Modi was already there. So there was no, in terms of trying to show equations as who walks in first, who waits first. India called for the meeting. India is playing host. So the Prime Minister was patiently waiting, seated on his chair. Behind him was the Indian flag. And then Nawaz Sharif walked in, Padmaja.
He's got those visuals.
Nawaz Sharif walked in. There have been handshakes all over. Now the two leaders have sat down. And the media, and the camera crew, everybody being asked to vacate the meeting area as the doors will be shut and the engagements will start. But we can see in the background these visuals even now. There is a certain level of warmth. It's not very cold. It's cautious. But there is some warmth between the two leaders, and one wonders whether there is a personal equation that will be struck, that because that has been the strategy that Prime Minister Modi has been trying to pursue with a lot of the international leaders, trying to strike a personal equation and then work around issues and problems and try and forge ties between two countries or bilateral ties between various nations. Now that's what he's been trying to do. So a very open handshake, very warm welcome from both sides. In fact, Narendra Modi perhaps a little more open in terms of reaching out to some of the Pak delegates beyond Sartaj Aziz. Nawaz Sharif taking cue from Narendra Modi and then following suit as he engaged with Ajit Doval and the rest of the members of the Indian delegation. If those pictures speak a lot. So there is some direction perhaps and some motive very strongly attached in terms of how the Prime Minister and the Indian Prime Minister wants to pursue the next 20 minutes and start or perhaps direct the discourse that will be held over the next 20 minutes. We'll see and we'll get the details, Padmaja, in just a bit. But over to you in terms of the atmospherics there.
Well, in fact, Anand, of course, a good analysis of body language would be needed perhaps to see how this is a movement from forward from when the two prime ministers had last met at Dhuli Kale in Kathmandu. Remember, there had been a handshake there as well at the retreat for which the SAARC leaders had gone. But this is, of course, moving beyond. Here you're going to have a bilateral dialogue. That was just a handshake. It was more of a formality because all the SAARC leaders were together over there. But if Mr. Karnad and Brigadier Mahalingam are still there with us. Mr. Karnad, I wanted to ask you, do you think that India is finding itself in a bit of an awkward position here in Ufa simply because there is a sort of joining of forces between China and Pakistan and that too at a multilateral summit? So you have China defending its stand at the UN where it supported Pakistan, and Pakistan yesterday again talking about how it's a victim of terror and how it is standing alone practically in fighting terrorism and has paid a price for it. So you have India on the one hand and two of its neighbors, China and Pakistan, presenting a sort of joint front.
Well, look, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization is essentially also has Russia, And Russia is the one that wanted India into the, and that's where I think we're going to get the membership from, even as China is promoting Pakistan, which is fine. Really, the point about this is that this is not a gang up and that sort of a thing. It is a meeting of heads of state of the SCO organization. Now, that being the case, to reduce it down to, China and Pakistan ganging up against India would, I think, be wrong. The larger issues that are on the table are really to have a kind of an economic union, a free trade area. Those are the kinds of things where the memoranda is, are going to be signed. And that's what Dmitry Merensev, the Secretary General of the SCO, said. That these are the larger issues that are on the table that are going to be signed by the members, and of course India and Pakistan will gain formal entry into it, and so this is going to be a good thing to have, and that's what these are the issues that are going to predominate,
okay.
Not the bilateral issues that are dragging things down all over the place.
But Brigadier Mahalingam, is it as simple as that? You know, a lot of people here also have echoed the views that Mr. Karnad just gave, that let's just deal with the hygiene issues first. If you're going to aim to resolve the Kashmir dispute at one bilateral meeting, it would be trying to achieve the impossible. So let's just get the hygiene issues out of the way. Let's get some trade pact signed. Let's talk about visa rows not being allowed in the future. And maybe that'll be a step forward towards a better future, better relations between the two countries. But is that enough?
No, I think I do not
agree
with the
Should we just take that approach as the most practical one and something that is even possible at this point?
No, I don't think so. Because you see, even in take the most favored nation's status, India granted that status to Pakistan way back in 1996. Till today, India not been given that status at all. The point is that as far as Pakistan is concerned, it is very keen to derive as much as they can out of India without giving anything to India. In fact, if I may tell you that this particular MNF status was denied to India at the instance of Pakistan's army. The secretaries of the economic ministries were called to the GHQ and they were told after a briefing that the commerce minister was to go there and this announcement was to take place about 2 years ago. Now, having said that, I also want to make a comment on one issue, that is the Pakistan's confidence in the entire issue. If you know, today the two world's mightiest countries, United States as well as China, are dependent on Pakistan for peace in Afghanistan, which is being brokered by China. Now, China, if you notice, is quite disturbed about the situation in Xinjiang, and they need Pakistan's cooperation, and Pakistan understands its importance in that particular issue, and to that extent they are confident and they are eluding confidence everywhere. And to that extent, I think India today is in a disadvantageous position. India has not been put on the high table in the Afghanistan conference, which took place recently in Muri. China was there, US was there, Pakistan was there, Taliban was there, and Afghanistan was there. That is the issue where India seems to have been sidelined,
and that's
knowing fully well India has certain strategic interests in Afghanistan.
And that's what I'm confused about, Mr. Like trade, people-to-people contact. But Pakistan still hasn't given us the MFN status. We still have our assets in Afghanistan being attacked by elements which find their roots in Pakistan. So what do we have to look forward to? As far as anti-terror cooperation, that's not happening. Cross-border violation, that's not stopping. Kashmir issue, obviously, that's too much to expect. But even basics like trade, we can't even seem to make any headway there with Pakistan.
No, I mean, the Pakistan state is the loser. There's something called switch trade that's happening all the time. The ships bound from bound ostensibly for Kuwait or Dubai or something go offshore and anchor offshore of Karachi, and boats come in and take all the Indian goods to the Pakistani markets. If you go into Pakistan, there's not a shop there that's not full of Indian goods. Where do you think these goods come from? So India doesn't lose out. It's the Pakistani exchequer that loses out by not giving us MFN status in a formal way. Because had they done that, they could have imposed levies on it, taxes. They would have made money. They would have gained an awful lot of revenue that way. But they haven't done that. So it doesn't hurt us. Let's be very clear that there's a switch trade happening that benefits us, that favors us. Now, the other things. What I said about the larger trade union is of the SCO. It's not just India and Pakistan and South Asia. They're talking about all the members of the SCO getting together to see if they cannot have some kind of a trade and an economic union, some kind of easy passage of commerce across borders and so on. So these are larger in a geographic space, these concern a larger geographic space than just a subcontinent which India and Pakistan deal with. When you have the larger understanding, it stands to reason that over time, the Pakistani and Indian resistances to formally having trade and other exchanges will break down. And I think that's going to happen.
True.
In the 21st century, you
let me now that the talks are on, and we are hoping that it will end. We are expecting it to end within 20-25 minutes from now. So let's put the two gentlemen in spot on the spotlight right now. Bharat Karnad and Brigadier V. Mahalingam. This is a point I'm going to ask you straightforward question. What Padmuja asked Sartaj Aziz and she asked Nawaz Sharif, I'm going to ask you now. One issue that you would like to see Mr. Karnad addressed, and one issue where you think India should score over Pakistan diplomatically in the next 20 minutes.
Well, look, it would help very much if there was a resumption of dialogue at the formal level to indicate, to symbolize a normalization to the extent that's possible in the Indian context, in the subcontinental context at the present time. The dialogue carrying on, issues being brought to negotiate, various programs and projects are already on the anvil, such as the Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, gas pipeline, such as the Turkmenistan-Tapi gas pipeline through Afghanistan. So these are the issues that I think ought to be stressed and emphasized. Whether it's going to happen or not, I don't know. But this is what I think the Indian side should try to achieve, because these are substantive issues where you'll get very quick benefits to everybody concerned. And that's what's going to, I think, maybe that's is also at the in the thinking of the Indian Prime Minister when he talks of the larger issues involved, even as he stresses perhaps the terrorism angle and so on. Because as
your focus is on trade. Your focus is on trying to
trade,
get
commerce, general loosening.
Yeah, and commerce,
of,
trade and commerce. You think will actually rule over the other sore issues or the sticky issues? Brigadier Mahalingam, your one big issue.
They would, yeah.
My one big issue. I believe that there is Pakistan must assure us that these terror camps, 36 of them, will be closed. Once that is done, the entire spectrum is available for talks. Without that, I don't see any logic in talking to Pakistan at all. And if you want to talk of trade issues, I would say put one particular issue on the mat, and that is today we have there is a transportation agreement between Pakistan and Afghanistan where Afghan vehicles can come right into India and deliver goods, whereas Indian vehicles cannot go. If that could be changed by Pakistan, that will be again another sign which I think would be positive.
Padmuja, going by what Brigadier Mahalingam wants, terror camps shutting down, impossible. Trade commerce, perhaps. So the aspect of trade and commerce looks far more likely than Pakistan agreeing to shut down the terror camps and stop infiltration, because Kashmir does not seem to get resolved, will not get resolved. So will the two nations actually say, let's keep the sticky issues aside and let's look at what we can work with, especially in terms of trade and development, given Nawaz Sharif's disposition of encouraging business and looking to further trade?
Actually, both things are going to be mentioned. As far as India is concerned, Anand, India is going to bring up the terror camps. They are going to say that there has been infiltration and this must be stopped. We have seen lack of action against the terror organizations that are trying to infiltrate into India from across the border. So all of that is going to be brought up for sure. But if we are expecting any assurance from Pakistan, that's going to be, I mean, of course, there will be platitudes about, yes, we must cooperate, there must be greater cooperation. But to expect that there will be some sort of a roadmap spelled out by Pakistan to say, yes, all of these terror camps will be eliminated, of course, that's too much to hope for. But yes, like Mr. Karnad also said, that there are going to be other issues which are going to be addressed, more practical, more doable issues, which are going to likely find mention by both the sides. So it's like one step at a time. Also, the other message, Anand, that we've learned India is going to give is that we have made a lot of peaceful gestures towards Pakistan in the recent past, but Pakistan's actions are not inspiring too much faith. We are trying our best to reach out, meet our neighbor halfway, and we would appreciate the same sort of reciprocity from Pakistan as well. So that's something that that India, the Indian side, is going to seek. And Mr. Karnad, how far do you think that can we really push Pakistan for some kind of assurance on terror, on acting against terror? What's the best we can hope for?
Well, I don't think Padmaja, we have Bharat Karnad with us at this point in time. We'll try and reconnect with him, but we are also joined by Lieutenant General retired B.S. Jaiswal. Good morning, Jaiswal Sahab. You've seen the visuals. I'm sure you've been following the broadcast. So let's bring you into this discussion with the same question. What is the one issue that you would like to see India address? Will you put terror ahead of trade and commerce, or would you want to start with commerce and trade and then go towards addressing the sticky issues?
First of all, I would say that in such a short span of just about 15 to 20 minutes, basically it's going to be atmospherics. If in case they can push forward the resumption of talks seriously, that would be the one thing which will be a great achievement. As far as Kashmir issue, terrorist issue, they're constant figures. But I think if we start off with economic convergence, you can express concern on Kashmir, on terror issue, but these can't be resolved in 15 to 20 minutes. My one take which is there, that I don't know why we are always defensive. Why do we say issues like Kashmir? Why are we not taking up cases of POK, of Sakshkam, which is our territory? We are being defensive time and again. We say, oh my God, Kashmir is ours. Kashmir is ours, so is POK, so is Sakshkam. Why are we not being offensive? We only keep taking nonsense from them. So these kind of issues cannot be resolved, you know, in just 20 minutes. I think matters of economic convergence, etc., can be done. Otherwise, it's just basically atmospherics. And resumption of talks, if that takes place, that would be a very good sign.
Well, Padmaja, we have Ambassador Neelam Deo, former diplomat, director, Gateway House, Indian Council on Global Relations, also joining us at this point. Do you want to direct your next question to her?
Yes, Professor Dev, thank you very much for joining us. Again, the one starting point that we are using for this entire discussion is, what do you think is a practical issue that we can actually move forward on when the two prime ministers meet today, if we have to make any headway in these talks?
Well, I think that, you know, practical issues and smaller issues really are not decided at the level of prime ministers. I would really say to you that the setting of this meeting has two important messages. One is that this meeting is taking place after India has participated in the BRICS summit. It is a message to the whole world that India is a big economy being taken seriously by the world. Pakistan is joining the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which is a security organization. And I think that is the second part of the importance of this meeting. India and Pakistan are joining the SCO. The most important thing that can be begin to be discussed, begin to be conceived, is connectivity to Central Asia, which is going to become more and more important. So I would say that small issues, I think, should be left to officials. But the most important message here is that India is this big economy. Pakistan is not. But both countries have an interest in talking together in the SCO, talking about Afghanistan, talking about connectivity, and trying to make progress on those issues.
So you don't see terror being talked about, Kashmir being talked about today. You think more the focus would be more on economic progress, trade and commerce. Yeah. Sorting out those issues at those levels, like Brigadier Malingam said,
no, I think
the trade channel via Pakistan into Afghanistan, the pipeline, Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, oil pipeline.
I think that both countries will set out their positions on terror and on Jammu and Kashmir. I don't think there will be any change in this short meeting. And those are things where small movement and little progress can be made. But it's painstaking. It has to be done at officials level or in back channel talks, the track two, the track three. But in this, I think the concept of India and Pakistan both benefiting from the energy pipelines and from being able to have connectivity and real trade with Central Asia, with Russia, is what should be on the map. And in my opinion, with that backdrop is perhaps why India has even sought these talks.
All right. Ambassador Dev, we'll just come back to you in a bit. General Jaswal, thank you. Good morning to you from here in Ufa. I wanted to ask you specifically about India, whether you think it has made concessions to Pakistan, and do you think this is a wise way to go forward? Do you think it's worth our while to give these concessions to Pakistan again and again, despite what they've done just yesterday? One Jawan killed in Kashmir.
No, I don't think that we should stretch any more concessions towards Pakistan. Time and again we keep talking about red lines, raising the bar. But thereafter we again, soften down and we give them, concessions. Whatever talks takes place hereafter, there should be conditions which should be set. There is no point because Pakistan doesn't understand. They always raise rhetorics against India, and every time we take a step forward, they take two steps behind. Whereas the Prime Minister has said, you take one step forward, we'll take two steps forward. Have they taken a step forward? No. So now whatever talks go on, we must set conditions. And there should be no more concessions.
I'm just going to go across to Ambassador Dev on this very point, General Jaswal, because along with you, other panelists also, Ambassador Dev, have expressed this concern that Pakistan's attitude always has been, how much can I extract out of my neighbor or out of you by giving nothing in return, little or nothing in return. Now, if that attitude continues, and is that something which everybody is aware of? It's an open secret. But how do you deal with a nation like that?
I think this whole situation and the relationship is very complex. I think we all understand, and it has been spoken about a great deal, the fact of whether the civilian prime minister is actually in control of everything, or that the army is what sets the red lines on how far he can go. If we want to deal with the Prime Minister, as we clearly do and as we clearly must as a democracy ourselves, then let us at least try and get some convergence on things which are not necessarily bilateral, which are not necessarily emotional, and then try to make progress from there. If the energy issue becomes important enough as it is to all the Central Asian republics, to China, to Russia, perhaps we can have some progress on that. But to make everything contingent on one issue or five specific individual issues is not going to take us any further.
No, General Jaiswal, sir, just going back to Ambassador Diofor, her perspective on whether or not you believe, you know, given your experience and India's issues with Pakistan, that we are engaging with just one entity, whereas we should engage with one more or another. So along with the democratic establishment, the civil representation, we need to engage with the army too. So should there be another, a third entity at the table?
Yes, I think we should engage with all stakeholders in Pakistan, civil society, academics, business, army, government, everybody. I do not see what we gain by not engaging with the armed forces.
But how do you do that? How do you do that? Because they seem to be pulling the cart in opposite directions. Because every time the civilian representation comes out and extends, the hand of cooperation, signals some breakdown or thaw in equations, the army goes and, you know, convolutes the plot altogether.
Well, you know, I think that very often we have engaged. After all, for decades, Pakistan has had military dictators. We dealt with Musharraf, we dealt with Zia, we have dealt with all of them. Why are we restrained about dealing with a serving army chief if we deal with them afterwards? In any case, you can also deal with the army in track 2, in track 1.5, or even just back channel. There are many ways, and I would like to just remind that the India-Pakistan dispute is not the first dispute in the world. All over the world there have been major differences, there have been wars among other countries, but everybody understands that they all have to deal with neighbors, with land neighbors particularly, and ways can always be found. That is what is the burden of creative democracy, creative diplomacy.
Do you believe that this government has got its approach confused with Pakistan? General Jaiswal is back with us. General Jaiswal, you know... Yes, Ambassador, make your comment. Yeah, make your comment, ma'am. Then I'll go to General Jaiswal. Jaiswal, sir, we lost you for a bit, but I had a follow-up question with Ambassador Deo. So I'll just go across to her and I'll come back to you, sir. Yes, Ambassador Deo, do you believe this government has got its approach to Pakistan absolutely confused? And will they sort it out today? Is that also a test for Narendra Modi?
I don't know the answer to that. I think any government makes some mistakes as it proceeds. I tend to believe that cancelling the Foreign Secretary talks was probably a mistake. But on the other hand, I support entirely this government taking charge of the relationship with Pakistan. They decide when they want to talk. They decide what direction the talks should take. I'm totally in favor of that.
So India leading the discourse is a good sign, but some of the tactical moves that have been made diplomatically perhaps were errors or perhaps wrong judgments at not at the opportune moment, and decisions not very opportune to what should have actually happened. Let's take a listen to what Mr. Sartaj Aziz told Times Now before I go back to our panelists.
Sartaj Aziz here with us. Sir, one issue you would like to see addressed?
Inshallah. All the issues.
All right, so you first heard it, Sartaj Aziz, saying that all the issues is what they want addressed.
Here is America's perspective when questioned on Indo-Pak ties, and this is just ahead in the build-up to this bilateral meet between the two prime ministers. Let's take a listen to what the U.S. spokesperson had to say.
The statement was made yesterday by the defense minister of Pakistan that we have bombs, nuclear bomb, and if needed, we will use against India, and also it is a warning to for India. So what do we make? What is the future? What role you think US can play to bring these two civilian governments on a table rather than involving the, because India's military is not involving anywhere in these talks or the intelligence agencies of India, but only it happens from Pakistan.
Well, look, I didn't see those comments, and I can't speak for how leaders in either country are going to make announcements on their on their bilateral relationship or, frankly, their bilateral tensions. I think we welcome the recent meeting between Indian and Pakistani leaders there on the sidelines of this conference, and we also welcome any steps that both countries can take to try to reduce the tensions. That's been our longstanding position. You heard the Secretary say it here just a couple of weeks ago. We want to see the tensions reduced, and we want to see these issues resolved bilaterally between the two countries. It's in nobody's interest for the tensions to rise and to increase, and for the tensions in the region to become less stable, you know, in many ways than they already are. You mentioned both want peace. That's certainly what we want as well. There's an awful lot of kids living in that part of the world who I think everybody wants to make sure they have a better future. And I think that's what we would hope the leaders in both countries are also trying to pursue. But this is ultimately, these are issues that we want to see them solve bilaterally.
Well, they say it is ultimately an equation, and it's bilateral. It's an issue between two nations, but it's an open secret that both the leaders and both the nations have been given this nudge by the United States to get back onto the table and engage. We'll take a very short break. Request our guests to do. Please stay on with us. Taking a short break at this moment. Join you back with more. Good morning, and thank you for staying with us as we stay on with this coverage. It's the big meet between the two prime ministers, Narendra Modi and Nawaz Sharif. India and Pakistan sitting across and engaging with each other roughly a year after the swearing in diplomacy happened. The meet is currently on. Bilateral talks are on. The bigger question is, will trade dominate the talks and terror be touched upon? Or will terror be the issue that is addressed the most and trade be the consequence of that? That is what we need to see, what the focus finally emerges of this meeting that has been called on, and the move has been made by India. And Ambassador Neelam Deo and General Jaswal with us at this point, Lieutenant General Jaswal with us, Ambassador Deo saying that it is nice that India is the one that is dictating the discourse, that's dominating the discourse and is also directing the discourse. It is India that's chosen to talk and engage with Pakistan. So does that prove fruitful for India? We'll have to wait and watch. But meanwhile, Padmaja is down in Ufa. She did try and get a comment from Sartaj Aziz. And here's what he said as the Pakistani delegation walked out of the hotel towards the meeting area.
Sartaj Aziz here with us. Sir, one issue you would like to see addressed?
Inshallah. All the issues.
All right, so you first heard it, Sartaj Aziz saying that all the issues is what they want addressed.
General Jaswal, coming across to you, Ambassador Deo also with us. General Jaswal, your thoughts. Ambassador Deo says that it's nice to see that it's India that's calling the shots, in the sense India decided we want to engage with Pakistan. Let's talk. They called for this meeting. But do you believe the focus will be more on trade and not terror? Would you want terror to be addressed first and trade as a consequence? Or trade to be spoken about, or trade to be addressed and terror be spoken about?
My narrative on this is that the basic problem with Pakistan and India is terror. So therefore, terror will definitely occupy a higher agenda, but it cannot be discussed in such a short span. So this will be just a mention. You see, these are not specific issues which can be discussed. Both trade will also be discussed, convergence in trade. I would like to make a mention, a couple of quick issues over here. One, you see, it is in India's interest to have a stable Pakistan. And Pakistan itself is suffering from terrorism. Therefore, terror will definitely occupy a position which is higher than trade. Trade, of course, will be mentioned. That is the way the dialogue is kept forward. But to say that in detail we'll talk on terror and Kashmir and trade in 20 minutes, well, sorry. What I feel will emerge is that ultimately we will say that yes, we must start a dialogue again. There'll be just atmospherics, you know, which will be discussed as of now, and terror would definitely occupy a higher place. That if in case we really want to move forward, yes, you have to address terror.
Yes, and even if the dialogue process gets back on track, it would be a significant achievement, Ambassador Deo. But here's my query, and I'm going to ask both our panelists to get in on it. First, to Ambassador Neelam Deo, this question. Is it difficult for India to learn from China? Because China continues to flex its muscle. But look at its presence trade-wise, economy-wise, across all the nations who have a problem with it, who have an ongoing issue with it, dispute with it. Why can't India learn from that model and adapt it or adopt it towards its engagements with Pakistan?
Well, I would say that India has been trying to implement that model with Pakistan. When we talk of trade and we try and expand the economic relationship, it is precisely what the Chinese have done with all the other nations, including India, with which they have serious differences, sovereignty differences, just as we have with Pakistan. It is Pakistan which has been unable to move on some of these issues in the past. But today, we both countries have such an opportunity. We must understand that trade and terror are two sides of the same coin. You cannot actually have a very powerful, strong relationship while terrorism continues. Why is it that Pakistan, we cannot suggest to Pakistan that let us have the Iran-Pakistan-India gas pipeline and you raise a brigade of 10,000 soldiers to guard that pipeline just as you are doing for the Chinese Silk Route through, the OBOR project that China is going to fund through Pakistan. I think that we have to understand and we have to make them understand and say it repeatedly also publicly that it is the economics of pipelines for gas, for oil is such that from Central Asia, from Iran, that unless India is also a buyer, nobody will put in the money only to supply Pakistan. And Pakistan's power situation is infinitely worse than what is our need for oil and gas.
So we have to tell them, you need us to survive. Now, have we been doing that right, General Jaswal? Have we got it right? Why haven't we been able to get our engagement with Pakistan right? In terms of attitude, we have not flexed muscle enough to put them in their place.
Economy,
and we have not thrown them freebies enough or shown them the softer side enough so that they realize that they can't survive without us.
Economy is the strategy of future. There has to be economic dependence of Pakistan on India. That's the reason we gave them the MFN status. They haven't as yet. The problem with our diplomacy, which I personally feel, I'm not a diplomat, but as I see, as a commoner, that we are not offensive in our stands that we take. All along, like I said a while ago, we've been defending, Kashmir is ours. It is jolly well ours. Why are we not addressing that issue? Why are we not asking Pakistan, why are you saying that you're being affected by terrorism, you're only taking on TTP and the terrorists on the West? When why are you not taking the terrorists like LET, JOD, etc. On the East? Why? The persona donna in Pakistan today who's spoiling the things for us is the Pakistan Army and the ISI. If you recall, when Nawaz Sharif, he took over, he wanted to extend a hand of a friendship towards India in a genuine manner. And he was snubbed by Kayani. Go slow. So though we have been trying to, but Pakistan has not come ahead at all to make us realize that yes, they are also genuine.
So we then automatically we need to ask, but are we engaging with the wrong Pakistan? And is there merit in what Ambassador Neelam Deo says, that we need to engage with the other establishments in Pakistan, which also control governance, which also control policy, which also make decisions which perhaps one aspect of the Pakistan establishment does not have control over. Have we got it all wrong there? Can we address that? Let's take a listen to what the White House had to say on the sidelines of this bilateral talks and this development. Here's the reaction when the question was posed just before these talks began.
The statement was made yesterday by the Defense Minister of Pakistan that we have bombs, nuclear bomb, and if needed, we will use against India, and also it is a warning for India. So what do we make? What is the future? What role do you think U.S. can play to bring these two civilian governments on a table rather than involving the... Because India's military is not involving anywhere in these talks or the intelligence agencies of India, but only it happens from Pakistan.
Well, look, I didn't see those comments, and I can't speak for how leaders in either country are going to make announcements on their bilateral relationship or, frankly, their bilateral tensions. I think we welcome the recent meeting between Indian and Pakistani leaders there on the sidelines of this conference, and we also welcome any steps that both countries can take to try to reduce the tensions. That's been our longstanding position. You heard the Secretary say it here just a couple of weeks ago. We want to see the tensions reduced, and we want to see these issues resolved bilaterally between the two countries. It's in nobody's interest for the tensions to rise and to increase, and for the tensions in the region to become less stable, you know, in many ways than they already are. You mentioned both want peace. That's certainly what we want as well. There's an awful lot of kids living in that part of the world who I think everybody wants to make sure they have a better future. And I think that's what we would hope the leaders in both countries are also trying to pursue. But this is ultimately, these are issues that we want to see them solve bilaterally.
Says it is for India and Pakistan to decide, but it's an open secret, like I said a short while ago, that the United States has nudged both the leaders and both the nations back onto the table. But let's pit the diplomat versus the army man with our next question. Ambassador Neelam Deo, this corridor which China is building with Pakistan is arguably on our land. So should India make an issue out of it? Should India claim rights on that land, on Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and ask Pakistan, how dare you lease out our land to China? Or should India try to benefit and allow this to happen and see how they can milk the economic advantage out of it?
Well, I think India has objected. It has conveyed its objections to the Chinese government. It has also objected publicly. But on the other hand, there's not a lot you can do because Pakistan and China are in occupation of that territory and have been in occupation of that territory for more than half a century now. I do not think that, I think it's too early for us to start talking about whether India can benefit from that or not. But it is not too early for us to begin talking even more seriously about the oil and gas pipelines that can bring fuel to India through from Iran and from the Central Asian countries. So I think that clearly there are people and economists in Pakistan who do see the benefit to themselves, but they also need to be heard more loudly, and they need to be given perhaps even more importance by the rest of the world and by us when they speak about the benefits of cooperation.
True. General Jaswal, has India shown itself as a weakling by allowing that to happen? They can make a lot of noise about what Pakistan and China have decided to do, but can do nothing beyond that. Now, is that a situation we would like to see ourselves? Because then can we really assert ourselves?
No, we are not a weakling at all. You see, the fact is that we have been objecting to it. We should raise the...
Yeah, General Jaswal, the question was to you, sir.
Ambassador, thank you. Thank you. We are definitely not a weakling. We have expressed our concern right from the time that 10,000 people, the Chinese troops were seen in the Gilgit Valley for road construction. this highway coming up has got a strategic implication, which most of us, well, we do realize, because if in case this strategic highway comes up, the Chinese army can also come via Pakistan onto the crown, and coming from Ksai Chin and coming from this side, there can be convergence onto a crown, that is Kashmir. And we don't have any economic advantage coming out of this highway, none whatsoever, hardly anything. And it totally offsets, the disadvantages, totally offset if at all there is any advantage. We have been raising this issue. We should raise this issue at the UN level and at various forums very strongly. I don't think the right kind of push has been given to this kind of objection that we should have been putting across. But definitely we are not weakling.
No,
we are concerned about
that.
I think our strategy.
You do not take kindly to that remark and that word or that adjective or associating that with India, saying that has India come out as a weakling. I'm saying it because definitely there is a lot of dynamics that is involved. It is important for India to make sure that this does not happen, because it's our land. Yes, it's disputed. But should this become the biggest issue at this point in time? That's another question. Before I go across to Ambassador Deo on that and her perspective, a reaction coming in from the Congress party, who are actually calling this entire meet a futile exercise.
Well, the fundamental question is, why is this meeting at all taking place? It is an exercise in futility. It is void ab initio. It is nothing more than a photo opportunity. These are the same people who for 10 years said that terror and talks cannot go hand in hand. These are the same guys who called off the talks because the Pakistanis or the Pakistani High Commissioner spoke to the Hurriyat. What has really changed? There was a breach across the LOC last night. A BSF Jawan has been killed. So this meeting is absolutely an unprecedented disaster. There is nothing to it. And you mark my words, you can start running it now, that the moment the meeting is over, every television will say, that it, channel will say it's an exercise in futility.
So the Congress before the meeting began calling it a futile exercise already, and Manish Tiwari putting his neck on the line saying that most of the channels and the media will call it as a futile exercise, not much came off, is what they will say soon after the meeting ends. So we'll see whether or not we have to hold up Mr. Tiwari for that. But let's take a listen to the BJP also. Siddharth Nath Singh reacted just before the meeting got underway.
इसमें जो जो चश्मा पहना जा रहा है उस चश्मे में ध्यान देना चाहिए कि जो बड़ी चीज है वो छोटी चीज के लिए मिस नहीं की जाए और इसलिए ये बड़ा इम्पोर्टेंट है कि क्या संदेश दिया जा रहा है भारत के की तरफ से और वो संदेश गंभीर संदेश है कि पाकिस्तान आतंकवाद पे अंकुश लगाए क्योंकि कहीं आगे समझौते होने हैं शांति में रहना है तो उसके लिए आवश्यक है कि आप आतंकवाद पे अंकुश लगाएं। दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण हमारे किसी भी जवान की मौत होती है तो वो भी एक संदेश है जिसको हमें देना है उनको पाकिस्तान को साथ ही साथ एक कड़ा संदेश भी भारत ने दिया है चाइना ने जो विरोध किया था लखवी का उस लखवी के उस विरोध पे भी भारत ने अपना दर्ज किया है अपना प्रोटेस्ट भारत के प्रधानमंत्री ने किया है साथ ही साथ यूनाइटेड नेशन में भी किया जो एक आतंकवाद जो एक मुद्दा पिछले 10 सालों में कहीं वो खो गया था वो और कश्मीर सेंट्रिक बनती जा रही थी आज आतंकवाद को भारत की सरकार ने मोदी जी की सरकार ने उसको फिर से विश्व पटल पे लाकर यूनाइटेड नेशन पे लाकर उस पे बातचीत करने पे मजबूर किया जा रहा है ये भारत की विजय है और साथ ही साथ पाकिस्तान को आतंकवादी राष्ट्र में घेरने का पूरा जो प्रयास है उसमें भारत को सफलता मिल रही है
So the BJP says we have put terror back on the table and we are forcing Pakistan, this government is forcing Pakistan to address that issue and this issue has been made the focal point of all future engagements. Now that's what the BJP says. We'll see what the net takeout is post the meeting. Here's what Sartaj Aziz told Padmaja Joshi just as they were walking out for this meeting.
Sartaj Aziz here with us. Sir, one issue you would like to see addressed?
Inshallah. All the issues.
All right, so you first heard it, Sartaj Aziz saying that all the issues is what they want addressed.
So Sartaj Aziz says all the issues should be addressed. The Congress already saying it's a futile exercise. Ambassador Neelam Deo, now, if this economic corridor is a cause for concern, like General Jaiswal said, and it allows China and Pakistan to try and crowd around or corner India on Kashmir from all sides, should India make this a big issue? Should India raise it? Should India also try and look at the option of countering Pakistan diplomatically by engaging with those in Gilgit-Baltistan and highlighting what Pakistan is doing there? And try and also assert our dominance and our occupancy and our ownership in terms of sovereignty on Pakistan-occupied Kashmir?
Well, I think that India has objected, and it is well known that we claim all these areas of Jammu and Kashmir of the erstwhile state. On the other hand, it's also well known that there is a line of control between the two countries, and that is treated as a de facto border between the two countries. Whether we make a louder noise or we don't, that is really up to the government and how much it feels the need to respond to media calls. I think that a meeting like this, after almost 1 year, it can try and set a direction in the overall relationship. It can't solve anything, but what it can do is to convey the importance that we attach. Obviously, we think terrorist activities directed against India are the most important thing, but having said that, you have to get on to all the other possibilities between the two countries and the other problems that the two countries face in the relationship as well. We cannot go into a meeting, no head of government goes into a meeting and continues to harp on just one issue. It has to be the totality of the relationship.
No, but the totality of the... See, the point is, General Jaiswal, look at China. They have occupied Tibet. What they have done is look at the fortifications that they have drawn all along the Indian border. Now, be it towards the northeast or up north, either ways, right across that entire line that they have with India, right along the McMahon line, and sometimes even beyond it into Indian territory, claimed Indian territory, they have got their fortifications in place. So tomorrow, and now they will have a corridor, and this comes through, they're going to be able to flank India from the Pakistani side too. But has India done the same kind of fortifications on our end? Or has this been overlooked? Or are we too overconfident about the possibility of such a thing happening?
Fortunately, I did command 4 Corps in the eastern sector, so I know that side also. You see, China is a very focused country. It has got a strategy of creeping assertiveness, then coercive strategy. In the east, it has got its communication systems coming up right up to the border. It has done formation cutting, etc., right up to certain areas which could become their launch pads. We have definitely lagged behind. Now we have taken a look. There are about 227 strategic roads which are coming up over there. As far as the endeavor in the West is concerned, you see, there is a strategy called a collusive scenario in the future, which could accrue on account of China and Pakistan, two-front war as you call it. I would call it as a collusive scenario. Well, definitely this strategic highway which is coming up on our west is definitely going to be very, very dangerous for us, because it's already in towards Aksai Chin, it is already there. So China, in its creeping assertiveness, it is being laying claims on our areas, Samdrung Chu, it has come, in eastern Ladakh, it's been coming in Chumar area, all along Depsang Plains, the Tri Junction, etc., everywhere. It is trying to come in. So that is part of the creeping assertiveness. Now it has got into the course of strategy also. You see, diplomatically trying to isolate India by getting on with, starting with Nepal, Myanmar, you go into Bangladesh, you go down to Sri Lanka, everywhere. It's trying to, Pakistan, of course. So now it's into that coercive diplomatic isolation of the country. And at the same time, It is sharpening its teeth. Should there be a
General Jaswal, sorry to interrupt you. General Jaswal, sorry to interrupt. Just an update coming in from Ufa. It's not a 15-minute meet. It's a 50-minute meet. 50 minutes. So it's been very, very long, the engagement. It's just come to an end. That's what we're given to understand, that it has just come to an end. We will try and go to Padmaja for more updates and see what the net takeout of these talks, subject matter of the talks were. We are also standing by for a briefing from the MEA spokespersons in just a bit. Pakistan side, will they brief, will they address the media? We do not know yet. There is no confirmation on that end. But the Indian side is going to hold a briefing in a short while from now. Perhaps more details will come forth then. But just this quick update before I go back to General Jaswal and Ambassador Deo, that the meeting was long. It's gone up to 50 minutes, 50. That's what we're giving to Anuja. Padmaja with us on the phone. Yes, Padmaja. So quite a long meet. Not 20 or 20 minutes or half an hour, but close to 50 minutes, close to an hour.
India graced Zimbabwe soil.
Padmaja, can you hear me? Well, I don't think we have the audio line through with her. We will try and get across to Padmaja in just a bit. But Ambassador, they also, something significant should have been discussed because the talks have gone. Yes, Padmaja is back with us. Yes, Padmaja. So 50-minute long chat that the two leaders have engaged in. Well, I've lost her on the phone again. We'll try and connect with Padmaja the soonest in just a bit. But Ambassador Deo, so should we say that there should be something fruitful out of this, the net takeout, because the engagement has been close to an hour. So way, way over scheduled.
Yes, I think a 45-minute meeting was scheduled and announced. But anyhow, I think that, yes, a lot of significant issues will have been discussed. And they will probably be able to announce at least one next step, next set of meetings with between the foreign secretaries, or some such next step is can be expected from this meeting.
Well, Padmaja Joshi joins us live at this point, and shortly we are also expecting a briefing. So Padmaja, 50-minute meet, productive. What's the mood overall?
Now. All right. In fact, I can tell you that the significant issues that were brought up, I'll just get back to you, Anand. I think we're having a bit of a concern over here. Just 2 minutes, we'll get back to you.
Right. We've been interrupted there that on that live broadcast. I think we should be able to get Padmaja back in just a bit. But she was just about to tell us some of the significant issues that have been addressed and that have been spoken about. We will try and get you those flashes in just a bit. But General Jaswal, now the briefing will say it all. How detailed it is and how many issues do they outline the MEA briefing? That would tell us the focus of this meeting.
Well, it's going to be a sweet and sour outcome, in the sense they would have been the atmospherics wherein it would have been mentioned that, yes, we must strike a dialogue, we must continue a dialogue. References would have been there, the sour part on Kashmir and India, talking about we being able to do Burma-like thing in Pakistan, and India responding by saying, sorry, you've been talking about your defense minister, you've been talking about nuke strikes, etc. So it's going to be a mixed thing. But the most important thing which I personally feel would come out is that we must resume dialogue and let there be issue-based discussions at secretary levels, not at the apex level of the prime minister as of now, because the grounds have not been prepared. And definitely, I personally feel like Mr. Doval had said, there have to be conditions for the resumption of dialogues. Definitely, every agenda is going to have a condition. And, that's what I personally feel.
No, but Ambassador Deo, resumption of talks, outcome. Would that be the biggest positive? Would you see it as a big positive, or would you see it as a natural outcome, given that India has initiated this meeting?
You know, I think it's very important that there continue to be engagement. So if they do announce when will be the next talks or at what level, I would see that as positive. It puts an end to the kind of suspended sort of feeling that there has been for the last year when there hasn't been much engagement until the Foreign Secretary went to Islamabad. I think that as much engagement as can be had is a positive. It provides more than one forum where views can be exchanged and messages can be passed. Of course, messages are always being passed also through third countries. We know that whether we want to admit it or not. And I think that the fact of the meeting is a positive, and I will see it as a real positive if they do announce now that a decision has been taken to hold another meeting between whatever level is felt appropriate, National Security Advisor or Foreign Secretary or whatever is the right level.
But should that meeting have a rider, General Jaswal, that let the governments engage before you engage with other parties? Don't engage with separatists on the eve of our governments engaging.
Definitely, these are the conditions which I am talking about. You see, you have to create an environment which is conducive for talks. I mean, they have again invited the separatists for iftar, your meal today. That is not fair. Once we have said that, sorry, you cannot interact with the separatists if you really want a genuine thaw of relationships. Well, yet they are calling them. And these very people, the separatists, they have been talking that, sorry, we are not Indian. Who are they then? Persona non grata. Arrest them. Don't allow them to go to Delhi. You see, on the one hand, Pakistan wants to say it's very genuine. It wants to initiate talks and we must resolve issues. On the other hand, it makes sure that it keeps, chipping in impediments like this. So therefore, there have to be conditions. Sorry, you will not talk to the separatists. You will not create conditions which are not in the spirit of talks. You will stop terror. You will not support terror bases right. in Pakistan. Then we can start and it has to be at the lower level. It cannot go at the apex level because the grounds have to be first prepared for apex level to be broached.
So that this meeting would have had certain back channel talks, Ambassador Deo. This meeting, this build up to this 50-minute meeting, there has had to be some kind of engagement so that there is some kind of a broad agenda to what will be discussed or what will be brought to the table. You also brought to perspective where this meeting is happening, on the sidelines of what. So do you believe that what we could hear in the briefing is that trade will dominate, terror would be talked about, but trade will dominate, and the next meeting would be perhaps more towards engaging in terms of trade and commerce and getting those sticky issues out rather than talking in terms of terror, addressing the issues of terror, addressing the issues of 2611, Zakir Rahman, Lakhvi and other points?
You know, I think one should not be too rigid in these matters and draw these red lines and put conditions, because then talks may not happen. I think the other thing we should understand is that in the Foreign Office briefing, they will certainly tell us what was talked about, or at least they will tell us about some of the things that were talked about. But obviously there will be much that will not be told, that cannot be made public. So I think we should see the Foreign Office briefing more like conveying the issues that were raised by us and by the Pakistani side when you listen to the Pakistani briefing. But we should not think that everything that was exchanged has been put in the public sphere. It cannot be and it should not be. So I think that we can't say that one is more important than the other. All of them are important, and in fact, to make progress, we have to have some progress in both, in the terror talks, in the economic talks, in on the, you know, border issues, water issues, all those things. But not all of them have to progress at the same speed or in the same extent. Some will move faster, some will move less, some will not move at all, because we do recognize that in Pakistan there is more than one center of power. So to make it impossible for ourselves to make progress by putting conditions is not helpful.
No, but this is the attitude, General Jaiswal, from Pakistan. We know very well that unless we talk a little tough, they won't take us seriously. It's all right, they'll make a little noise, but we'll continue to do what we want. Now, that is not an attitude which we want Pakistan to think that they can harbor and they can get away with. So now that this engagement has happened for 50 minutes, what would be now let me ask you again. It's been a long talk.
Yeah.
Would you want to see those riders in place? Or do you or do you perhaps will fall in line with what Ambassador Deo says, that we cannot put in conditions, otherwise talks won't happen? Sir, please stay with me. I'm going across to Padmaja. She's on the phone with us.
With due regards to the
I think we have her live. Well, Padmaja, I hope that issue was sorted, because we thought you were being barred from standing live from that position wherever you were. Now, I see you have moved to somewhere which is acceptable to the security protocol. Tell us what happened in that meeting. 50-minute meeting, it's gone beyond schedule. What was the net takeout?
Well, in fact, there was a warm handshake between the two prime ministers when they met. Prime Minister Modi was already waiting for his Pakistani counterpart. And after that, in the meeting that went on, three things that we've been told about were brought up. One, of course, is the $46 billion economic corridor that passes through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir between Pakistan and China. That's something that India expressed concern about. It had also been brought up earlier in the meeting that Mr. Modi had with Xi Jinping. The other thing, of course, was the lack of action against Zakir Rehman Lakhvi, the fact that he was allowed to walk free. And the third was the continuing infiltration into India from Pakistan. So these three main issues, the three main talking points, have found mention in the talk between Pakistan and India. But really, it's the deliverables that India is now going to be looked at. True to the Indian position earlier, terror was one of the main talking points when the leaders of the two countries met, taken up very strongly by India. In a while from now, Anand, we are expecting a briefing by the Indian Foreign Secretary. And after that, there will be a briefing by Pakistan as well. However, Pakistan still has two bilaterals lined up, so the briefing will probably be after the Indian side has already said its piece.
But traditionally, in terms of these engagements, Pakistan has always waited to see what India says in the briefing, and then they have had their briefing. So it is not very surprising, Padmaja, that Pakistan will delay its briefing, perhaps hiding behind the fact that they have other bilateral engagements. But three sticky issues that we thought India should raise, India has raised. But were these issues just touched upon? And have there been inroads made as far as trade and commerce is concerned? That's the other side of the coin. Or did the discussions largely weigh in only on these matters, especially the economic corridor?
Well, in fact, India's concerns in the past also have been very clearly articulated by the Prime Minister, especially on the issue of Lakhvi. Like we said earlier, the fact that he has been allowed to walk free was something that India wanted to take up at the UN. That, of course, was blocked by China. India expressed its concern about that. Again, this is something that has been brought up by the Indian side in today's talks as well. The second thing is the economic corridor that India spoke about. Of course, Pakistan's stand at present is that it's India commenting on Pakistan's internal affairs. They do not want India to talk about it. And according to Pakistan, this is in interest of better connectivity and better growth for the entire region, and it should not be viewed through the prism of only China and Pakistan and Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, through which this corridor runs. So yes,
Padmaja, just wait on. I think we have former President Waseem Sajjad with us on the phone. Former President Pakistan, good afternoon, sir. Good morning, sir. Thank you for talking to us. Your expectations from this 50-minute meet, what are the expectations Pakistan has brought to this meet?
Well, I think it's a very positive development. And what we expect from this is that the relations between Pakistan and India would move towards normalcy. And we will try and resolve our issues through dialogue, which is the only civilized and proper and practical way of moving forward. I think for the past few months, there's been a lot of tension between India and Pakistan, which is uncalled for and unnecessary. Both countries need to develop further, and peace will bring dividends to both India and Pakistan. I think there's a lot to be gained by peace and by normal relationship between the two countries.
But along with de-escalation of the tensions, would you think that addressing the issues of terror will be important, because Pakistan has a stated position on terrorism made by Nawaz Sharif himself. But do you believe they can have good terrorism and bad terrorism, this kind of a logic? Will Pakistan ease out in terms of backing infiltration?
I think all the issues between Pakistan and India, which include terrorism, which include Kashmir, which include trade, which include normalcy, movement between the two countries, I think all these issues need to be discussed, analyzed, and we need to move forward on all these issues. I don't think we can just pinpoint one and say, well, this is an issue between us. I think all these issues need to be resolved for the two countries to move forward.
Well, there is always this give and go. So if terrorism is raised by India, Kashmir is raised by Pakistan, 2611 raised by India, Samjhota Express raised by Pakistan. So you are aware of this. So let me ask you this. After this meeting, what is it that you would want to hear which will make you believe that there has been some significant progress in the dialogue?
I feel that we need to resume the composite dialogue between the two countries. We need to discuss all issues between the two countries. I don't think there is necessity or need for pinpointing only one issue and saying, well, this is the issue. Both countries have issues. Both countries would like to resolve those issues. And I think whatever issues India wants to raise, whatever issues Pakistan needs to raise, they should be discussed, and we need to move forward.
So you're saying that if the composite dialogue process is brought back, that would be perhaps the most dialogue is back on track, then that would be perhaps the most significant takeout?
I would say so. I think if the composite dialogue is back on track and we enter into a dialogue with a view to finding solutions, not just dialogue for the sake of dialogue, but with a view to moving forward, with a view to resolving issues, with a view to adjusting each other's points of view and moving forward.
But do you also believe that in terms of the other establishment in Pakistan, would it have also sent across a message or in terms of what Nawaz Sharif can commit to? Because, sir, with due respect to Pakistan's, civil, leadership, every time there has been a progress made by the democratic outfit, the military establishment, ministerial establishment has actually taken two steps back or pulled the cart in the other direction. That's why I'm asking you this, sir.
My view is that this is a wrong impression. I think the entire Pakistan, people of Pakistan, would like to resolve these issues. And whether it's military establishment or civil establishment, all of them would like these issues to be resolved. So let's move forward. And let's not just get involved in technicalities and try and, create issues which don't really need to be raised and which need to move forward in a really broad-minded way, discuss everything, whatever India wants to raise, whatever Pakistan wants to raise. Okay, let's sit down and talk. This is the only civilized way in which we can resolve our issues.
Do you also believe economic cooperation and focusing on trade and improving trade and commerce is perhaps the way forward, and then the other issues like terror, like occupancy, sovereignty will get addressed?
Lord, I think we need to explore all avenues of cooperation. There should be more movement between the two countries. Visa restrictions should be eased. We should try and develop exchanges at the political level, the economic level, cultural level, everything. But always there are impediments. You have some issues, Pakistan have issues. Let's sit down and talk about them and move forward. I think we should break from the past and look to the future.
Mr. Waseem Sajjad, thank you very much for talking to us. So that was the former Park president speaking to us here on Times Now. Going back to Padmaja Joshi. Padmaja, so three issues that were raised. And in terms of trade, in terms of the briefing, when are we expecting the briefing to start?
Yeah,
The Indian delegation, I learned, has already left from where the meeting was taking place. So you can expect the Foreign Secretary's briefing to start in about 10 to 15 minutes from now. That's, of course, the Indian Foreign Secretary's briefing that will be taking place. And we will hear in more elaborate detail, specifically about whether the resumption of Foreign Secretary level talks will take place. That's going to be a major issue to watch out for. So after the meeting of the two prime ministers, will the foreign secretaries of the two countries also meet? Remember, these were talks that had been called off earlier in August last year when the separatists had met the High Commissioner of Pakistan to India. So is there going to be a resumption of that dialogue? That's going to be one of the main things to look out for in the briefing. And to be there were any assurances forthcoming from Pakistan on the issue of Zakir Rehman Lakhvi. The issue also, the other important thing was that India reiterated its position on the amount of evidence and the nature of conclusive evidence that has been given to Pakistan over time on the involvement of Zakir Rehman Lakhvi in the 2611 attacks and how a lack of action against him is being viewed very seriously back home. And of course, finally, there is the economic corridor between China and Pakistan that also found mention. How did Pakistan respond to that? We've already heard a statement coming earlier from Pakistan's finance minister who said that this is meddling interference by India in Pakistan's internal affairs. That's what the finance minister of Pakistan had said earlier. So what was the reaction of the Pakistani prime minister today? That is again something that we hope to hear from the foreign secretary when he speaks the media in just a while from now on.
Are not important, but this economic corridor suddenly becomes changes the dynamic altogether in terms of the larger geopolitical environment around us, because this is two neighbors with whom we have perennial troubles who are actually engaging with us on land which is claimed by us, which is, India claims it's its territory. So that is what is actually happening in terms of the dynamics. And perhaps that is a cause for concern. But Padmaja, is there a commitment from Pakistan that we cannot keep Lakhvi behind bars right now because we have goofed up in terms of prosecuting him, but we will get him to lie low. We'll keep an eye on the elements like Lakhvi and Hafiz Saeed. Is that kind of a commitment that's coming forth from Pakistan? Padmaja, can you hear me?
Anand, could you please repeat the question?
Come forth from Pakistan that we cannot put Lakhvi behind bars? We have goofed up on prosecuting him, but we will keep an eye on him. We will urge him to lie low. We will urge get the likes of Hafiz Saeed to control and curb their movement. Is there a commitment like that coming forth from Pakistan to try and assuage India's concerns, to try and take this process forward?
Well, realistically speaking, what Pakistan is likely to say is that the law is taking its own course. If Zakir Rehman Lakhvi has been let out on bail by a Pakistan court, there is nothing that the government can do to interfere in the judicial process. That is likely going to be the response of Pakistan. That's what we've been hearing. Whether the Prime Minister himself said anything, whether Sartaj Aziz himself said anything, whether anything specific, any assurances were given by Pakistan, that's something that the Foreign Secretary will tell us in a while from now. But I can tell you that this is the stand of Pakistan, that this is a due judicial process is being followed and the government cannot interfere in it. And that's why Zakir Rehman Lakhvi has been allowed to walk free, because that's what the courts have decided. So that's as far as Lakhvi is concerned. The other issue being the evidence that India has given, again, Pakistan is going to say that that has been placed before the court and ultimately it's for the judiciary to decide, and that's where the matter rests as far as they are concerned.
No, the soft approaches. Is there any information on whether or not cricket diplomacy will be there, whether or not India will come out and announce that the team will travel to Pakistan or play matches with Pakistan on neutral grounds, either in India or in Dubai, where it was what was being talked about as far as the schedule for December, whether or not there will be cultural engagements. Now, are we expecting some announcements like these? Because that could be a cue whether or not the dialogue process is back on track.
Mm-hmm. So three major doables which we are likely to hear about. First is to facilitate the movement of people between India and Pakistan. People-to-people contact, that's been spoken about again and again. The confidence building measures that you just mentioned, Anand. The other thing is cricket diplomacy. We're waiting to hear on that. And finally, it's the resumption of the foreign secretary level talks. That's going to be really the highlight. But the positive moves forward, it's going to be around these three major points. Easier movement of people between the two countries, resumption of foreign secretary level talks, and of course also the resumption of cricketing ties between India and Pakistan.
So these confidence building measures could be talked about, some announcements could be made. Was the issue about the attaches visa being rejected, the naval attache, was that also raised, and why India blocked the passage of who was somebody who was an ISI agent and also a terrorist handler?
Now, also, again, even before the talks had started, Anand, these were issues that India said were of concern to it. But now that this sort of a gesture has been made by India in reaching out to Pakistan, seeking these talks on the sidelines of the SCO, what India's stand was that these are a number of gestures that we have made. These are sort of an olive branch, and what we expect from Pakistan is to meet us halfway. The other significant thing, Anand, is also the statement that has come from the United States in the middle, where it has said that it appreciates the meeting that is taking place between the two countries. They want regular talks to take place. They want a resumption of dialogue between the two countries, because any tension in the area is inimical to the interests of not just the two countries involved, but the entire region. So the United States has also weighed in and said that this is something that is welcome to the international community. And in fact, resumption of dialogue would be something that the international community would look very favorably at.
Whereabouts are you at this moment? Because we're given to understand that the foreign secretaries of the two nations are also meeting. So are the Indo-Pak foreign secretaries, are they speaking and are they engaging at this point in time, Padmuja? And there is a lot of activity around you. Are you somewhere nearabouts where we are expecting the MEA briefing to happen to?
Well, in fact, Anand, we are at the hotel of where the Pakistani delegation is staying. And like I mentioned, they have another two bilaterals lined up. So first, we'll see a briefing by the Indian Foreign Secretary, which is going to happen at the hotel where the Prime Minister is putting up. It's going to happen at the Sheraton. And we're expecting that to start in a while from now, where all of these issues will be elaborated upon. We'll also have more clarity on exactly what was the response that we got from Pakistan, because we already know the issues that India was going to raise, and they have been raised by the Prime Minister. Whether we came away with any reassurances, any confirmations, any responses from Pakistan, that's something that first the Indian Foreign Secretary will talk about, and then we'll also hear from Pakistan.
Well, Padmuja, do stay on with us. Going across to Sachin Pilot of the Congress Party, who's joining us on the phone at this point. Sachin, thank you for talking to us. More importantly, three issues that we know have been touched upon, which India said that they will raise. The issue of Zakir Rahman Lakhvi, the construction of this economic corridor between China and Pakistan, and also ceasefire violations. So India has talked tough on terror. But earlier on, the Congress Party, Manish Tiwari, said this is a futile exercise.
Well, I don't think the government of the day has a very concrete Pakistan policy. I think it's fine to have bilateral meetings, but there must be concrete outcomes that one has expectations of. I don't know if we've done enough to kind of have a way forward in terms of what our needs are from a close neighbor. The economic corridor that China is investing heavily in POK and other parts of Pakistan is actually something that we must take up very strongly. And the export of terror that has happened continuously over for the last decade and a half hasn't admitted. The firing on the LOC, the infiltration exercise that is still carrying on, is something that bothers the Indian agencies and the Indian government a lot. I don't know if the Prime Minister has really been able to get assurances from his counterpart on the discussions today. I think more we'll get to know when the Foreign Secretary briefs the media. But these meetings, I think, must lead to something concrete, because the Prime Minister invited Nawaz Sharif ji for his swearing in. But post that, the way the secretary-level talks were called off because of the Hurriyat leaders meeting the High Commissioner, I mean, this is a very, you know, one step forward, two step backward, a confused, knee-jerk reaction sort of Pakistan policy. And I'm just hoping that this bilateral meet that they've had this morning doesn't end up just being a Photoshop and a handshake.
Well, the foreign secretaries of the two nations are currently engaging with each other, and if the composite dialogue process were to come back into place, fall back into place, would you credit this government for getting and sorting itself out?
I don't think a dialogue is sufficient at this stage. There must be assurances that the Indian government must get, because the infiltration is still carrying on, and the firing on the LOC and the disturbances on the border have only increased in the last few days and months. And more so, what's happening in Kashmir, you know, the kind of robust movement of the underground agencies and militants from across the border hasn't stopped. So a composite dialogue is only one part of the discussion that they've had, but they must get solid assurances from the highest levels in Pakistan that these infiltrations will stop, and there must be an international commitment. We must not get bogged down by what's happening between China and Pakistan, and then just a handshake and a verbal lip service is not enough for India at this point.
Sachin Pilot, thank you for talking to us. We will come back to you for more reactions once we get a complete briefing from the MEA. Right now, going across to Brigadier Asif Raja, joining us from Islamabad. Brigadier Saab, good morning, sir. Thank you for talking to us. Now, how positive is Pakistan about getting back on the table and engaging with India? And is all of Pakistan engaging with India right now?
I don't think there is any sense of hope or positivism seen in Pakistan, seeing how the relation between Pakistan and India have gone ever since Narendra Modi has taken over. Not the relation between the two countries were any good earlier on, but ever since Modi has taken over, things are going down and have now reached the rock bottom. As you know that Nawaz Sharif, irrespective of whatever the attitude was on the other side, he had taken a very good initiative and had gone there to attend his ceremony and extended a warm handshake. And even, you know, just to please or appease Modi, he didn't meet any Kashmiri leaders, which was, of course, resented here in Pakistan, that why did he not do so? And even till today, he's being, put on the mat as to why he did this act and met all other and not the Kashmiri Huriyat leaders and that kind of thing. So, you know, the initiative has always been from Pakistan's side, right from the time the conflict dialogue started in 1997 onwards, to have a good friendly relationship and have good neighborly relationship, because that is what is in interest of the two countries, particularly when the two countries
It sounds very nice, Brigadier Saab, when you say all of this. And it's not about taking credit who's engaging, who's initiated the dialogue, because this time around it is India that's initiated the dialogue. So we'll get into a one-on-one in terms of taking credit. But the issue is Pakistan walking the talk? It sounds very effusive when you talk like this, that Pakistan wants peace, Pakistan wants good bilateral relations. Then why are there 36 terror camps on your side? Why is there infiltration? Why is there ceasefire violation? Why haven't the 2611 perpetrators not been brought to justice? Why are some people who are taking lives of innocents being allowed to roam scot-free, saying that they are free citizens of Pakistan? So there has to be some intent that has to come across, sir. Now, you can point, turn around and say, what has India done? But let's first try and explain what Pakistan has done, sir.
Gandhi, and bilateralism was the new buzzword which had emerged, that no outside power, but both would, sit together and sort out all the bilateral matters. And what were the bilateral matters? The core issues. And the most outstanding core issue was the Kashmir dispute. Others came later on, like the Siachen and the Sar Creek and the water dispute and all that. What has India done on that? We are the victims of aggression of all these things. And we want, these things to be resolved. And because without that, how can you expect peace, and how can that mistrust
So you don't want to engage on Kashmir, you don't want to speak on Kashmir, or are you going to say that till the time there are dialogues or India and Pakistan sit on the table and talk, our guns will continue to speak, we'll continue to help and proliferate infiltrators? Now, is that a right position to take? Because what the concern is, we do not know, the people of India and also this government does not know who to engage with. Is it the army, the ISI that calls the shots? or is it the democratically elected civilian government that calls the shot? And you will know, you will know it very well. So why don't you spell it out, sir? Who should India engage with?
Wrong conception that is prevailing, you know, that our military is calling the shots here. In fact, if I say that the RAW and the Indian military is calling the shots there in India, that will be more right.
Because
if you remember Rajiv Gandhi having come
here,
and there was...
No, even for rhetoric, you cannot use that excuse. Even for rhetoric, Brigadier Saab, with due respect, you cannot use that excuse. Because what happens is very evident. The reluctance from Nawaz Sharif, the amount of engagements that he had to undergo, even to make that visit to India, when it was all SAARC leaders who were invited, you know it very well. When you're according Nawaz Sharif credit, you also have to accept that he was permitted. He was allowed to come. He was allowed to come. So are you going to deny that the army and the ISI don't have a significant say in engagements with India? And every time talks are back on track, efforts are made to keep it derail them, because otherwise the army loses relevance there.
Up that factory level stocks and all that. It was just without any reason.
No, I'm asking you, Brigadier Saab, you can be very honest. Please say that the army has its own vested interests and you have to engage with the army, then we will do it diplomatically, sir.
Because Kashmir is a dispute and it's,
No, but is that dispute going to be solved with violence? Via proxy war? Is that dispute going to be resolved via a proxy war? Our Kashmiri is not people. Our Kashmiri is not human beings. Is it okay to get people, armed militants, into Kashmir to take innocent lives?
To come and show that there is a change of heart.
No, Brigadier Raza, my question is straightforward.
There is no change of heart.
Brigadier Raza, where is the intent from Pakistan? Sir, where is the intent from Pakistan? Have your guns gone silent?
Months together.
No. Brigadier Saab, let me ask you this. No. Sir, I am saying one quarter. One quarter. Let the army, ISI, the park rangers assure that their intent is for one whole quarter, there will be no ceasefire violation. We will not push infiltrators. And we will negate all those training bases and camps which are actually training youngsters to wield guns rather than lift the pen. They are educating them in warfare, in taking lives, rather than educating them in the basic arithmetic.
Listening to it, but now no one will listen to your talk of terrorism, because now it has been proven and Modi has himself said that they were fully involved in the breakup of Pakistan in 1971.
No, and no. Your that was helping Bangladesh. Helping Bangladesh is not terrorism. Helping Bangladesh is not terrorism. Freeing 90,000 Pakistani soldiers, is a gesture. Is a gesture of humanity. We could have held them as prisoners of war. So let's not divert. Let's not try and divert the topic. See, it's very nice. It's very nice to this misdirect is very, very. It's a standard operating procedure of all guests coming in, especially with an army background. From Pakistan, sir. Brigadier Raza, I'm speaking to you with a lot of respect, and I understand you would please stick to Kashmir and tell me this. Can you show intent from Pakistan that they want to peacefully resolve what they consider a dispute? Sir, can you show me a single quarter? I'm not even asking for 6 months or a year, sir. I'm saying, can you show me a single quarter in the last 60 odd years where the guns from across the border have not fired on innocent civilians on this side, just so that you could push through people with guns to kill innocents?
They have been using money to topple governments in Indian occupied Kashmir, and also paying money to the leaders, you know, who have been, you know, the puppet leaders, of occupied Kashmir.
No, Brigadier Saab, again, Brigadier Saab, what I'm saying is, you are saying India is wrong. No, you are saying India is wrong. India's actions are questionable. My question to you, sir, is, where has Pakistan shown the intent and said that their actions are beyond question? Where has Pakistan shown the intent and said their actions are beyond question? Yeah, last night a BSF Jawan has died. I can show you civilian houses which have seen shelling. Now, is that right? Do you believe just because your polity and your army has a stated position, and politically you believe that Kashmir is a dispute, so aren't Kashmiris people? aren't their lives important? Is it okay? No. Tell me this, Brigadier Saab. How is it that you are going to say that you actually are, you're concerned about Kashmiri people when all you're doing is sending people to kill Kashmiris? Kill people in Kashmir.
Let us now...
To cause terror in Kashmir.
History of Kashmir...
No, I'm not even going to the history. I'm saying what's happening today. The tunnels come in from on your side of the border into ours. They are dug like that. So who's sending people, sir? So I'm saying you want to resolve Kashmir? Do you want to do it peacefully or via proxy war? What is Pakistan's stated position? I'm asking you, sir.
Article 370, which gives special status...
Sir, given your army background, I am asking you, sir. What is your position? Do you believe Kashmir issue should be resolved peacefully or via a proxy war?
On a hostile posture, there has been no reconciliation or no effort to patch and all that. The minimum that they
You started this morning by saying that Pakistan has taken the effort. You said that Pakistan has always moved forward and always engaged in talks. I'm saying prove it, sir. Show to the world that all those training camps are shut down. Show to the world that there is no more training youngsters, young men, encouraging them to lift guns and learn how to kill rather than how to learn to read and write. Empower them with tools rather than with guns. If you can do that, sir, then Pakistan can show to the world, here is our intent. Then you can turn around and tell India, now you prove your intent. But till then, how can you point fingers at the other?
Now you see, you remember when General Musharraf came, and you know that peace treaty was signed, and before that...
I remember when General Musharraf came out openly and said that we had given them army status. They were rangers and mujahideen who were rewarded being given army status to enter and infiltrate Kargil. I remember that General Musharraf. Are you talking about the same gentleman?
And all the cross LOC movement...
Sir, are you talking about the same gentleman?
It was as a result of those very, very deliberate acts that had taken place from Pakistan side, much to the chagrin of the people of Pakistan, that the liberation movement had, you know, come down as far as its intensity was concerned. And despite, you know, the fencing of the LOC and having taken such harsh measures and killing more than 1 lakh Kashmiris and detaining thousands and thousands and raping 10,000 and more of women there, what has happened? From 2008 onward, unarmed uprising has taken place without any weapon, including the small children, 7, 8 years, and those also have been killed. So what is the kind of democracy and the secularism which was the buzzword of the Congress?
Brigadier Saab, may I ask you something? Can you point fingers at India when the tunnels being dug are from your side? The training bases are at your side. The youngsters who came on to Mumbai city came from Karachi. They were youngsters. They came and killed more than 166 people in cold blood. They didn't look at their age, their gender, their religion, caste, creed, whatever. They were innocent citizens who were killed. They were trained on your soil. So be it 2611, be it what is happening regularly in Kashmir, It's all coming out of Pakistani soil, sir. Can Pakistan come out and say, we have stopped all of this? We have stopped all of this. Can you say that even for one single quarter that Pakistan has stopped all of this? If you cannot say, sir, then I don't think you have a right to call anybody names.
India and none else.
No, sir, my question is straightforward. Who is warmongering? Who is warmongering? Who is conducting this proxy war? And then saying that we want to talk peace.
What is happening now?
You're still not responding to my straightforward question.
Pardon?
You're still not responding to my straightforward question. Four youth had four Indian. My simple question to you, Brigadier Saab, is had four or five Indian youth landed in Karachi and killed 200 people. Would you have tolerated it? Would you have accepted it?
If you would not have accepted it, how are you okay
by not bringing to justice five or six youth coming in from Karachi and killing innocents in India? How are you okay with that?
And the
so where is the intent Pakistan has shown in bringing those to justice?
Getting
so you prove it, sir. Let your courts prove it. Let your government prove it. Let your prosecutors prove it. That wherever it is, terrorism will not be tolerated, and we will not tolerate elements like these.
Pardon?
I am saying, where have your courts, where is your government, and where has your prosecution proved that killing innocents is not tolerated wherever in the world? Because if that was the case, the 2611 perpetrators would have been brought to justice, sir. Because let me ask you this. Will you have tolerated five Indians coming into Karachi and killing 200 innocents? Will you have tolerated it? Will you have accepted it? Will any sane human being accept this act of barbarity?
All the evidence.
If they will not, then why have you? Why are you dragging your feet rather than saying we will lead by example? Pakistan is not a country that everybody makes out to be, especially India makes out to be. We will bring terrorists to justice. Show that, sir. That's my straightforward appeal. That's not happening. Sir, his boy was born in his origins are in Muridke. Your own Pakistani media and your own people have turned around and said who these people are and where their origins are. It's all being muzzled. So let's not get into all of that.
I said they were put under trial and they are carrying up and they have been given bail.
Brigadier Saab, can you believe your own words? Can you believe your own words? I don't think I am able to get out, elicit any reason out of you. Padmaja is joining us from Russia. I hope you can reason with Brigadier Saab.
Brigadier Asif Raja, I wanted to ask you just a simple question. From the Pakistani establishment, we've heard everyone welcoming this meeting that has taken place between the premiers of India and Pakistan. But what hope do we have of your Prime Minister of actually delivering whatever he says to us? He can promise us the moon here in Ufa, but how much of freedom, how much of a leeway does he really have? Because it is your establishment back home which is ultimately going to pull his strings. Isn't that a fact? So what use are these atmospherics?
Padmaja, I think you'll have to repeat your question. We seem to have a very poor audio line with Brigadier Saab.
Yes, Brigadier Raja. Yes, Brigadier Raja, what I wanted to ask you was that how much of what Mr. Nawaz Sharif promises here.
Let me just check with Brigadier Raja. Brigadier Asif Raja, can you hear Padmaja? She's trying to ask you a question. She's joining us from Ufa. She's our news editor. She's in Ufa at this point in time and she's been speaking to the Pakistani delegation members. She will be speaking next. Please confirm you can hear her clearly. Yes, Padmaja.
Yeah.
Yes, Brigadier Raja, I wanted to ask you, how much do you think your Prime Minister can actually deliver on whatever he promises here, promises India here in Ufa? Because ultimately his strings are being pulled by someone else and it's a fact universally acknowledged.
No, I'm sorry, inaudible.
Okay, Brigadier Saab, I'm just going to rephrase that question. I'm going to ask you this. I hope you can hear me. Now, Padmaja is asking you, how much of what Nawaz Sharif promises in that bilateral meeting or Pakistani delegation agrees to with India, how much of it can actually be honored? Because what she is asking you is somebody else pulling the strings, somebody else calling the shots.
No, absolutely, it's all rubbish. No one is pulling the strings or nobody is putting pressure. Nawaz Sharif is an elected leader and he stands on his own feet and he has the mandate of the people of Pakistan. There's no doubt in that. And what you are referring to about the military establishment and all that, they work in their own place and they work according to the government, what the policies are given to them. And now that Nawaz Sharif has gone there in Ufa and he's meeting all the leaders and he is also likely to meet Modi, He will be.
Brigadier Raja, with due respect, we've heard that being said a number of times, but an equal number of times. And I also like to get in General Jaiswal at this point. How many times, General Jaiswal, have you actually heard it being said that the Pakistani Prime Minister, no matter who it is at that time, has got the permission of the deep state to engage with India or someone else? So what hope do we hold out from Mr. Sharif?
Kindly repeat her question.
Brigadier Raja, that question was to General Jaiswal. General Jaiswal, you heard Padmuja there. She was asking you how many times in the past also we've heard that she's got... Can you hear me now, sir?
Yes.
I'm just going to our other panelists, Brigadier Raja. I'm going to Lieutenant General Jaiswal. Lieutenant General Jaiswal, can you hear me?
Yeah. Acha Jaiswal.
Yeah, Lieutenant General Jaiswal, I'll try and get your audio up also. And Padmuja was asking you that how many times in the past have we seen Pakistan leaders of heads of state actually come out and the statement being made that they have got permission from the deep state to engage. So it's happened oftentimes in the past. So how is it that this time around Nawaz Sharif can commit to anything or honor anything that he commits to?
Initially, when Nawaz Saab, he took over the reins in Pakistan, he said that I want to have friendly relations with India and I want to extend a friendly hand towards India. The chief, General Kayani, he told him, go slow. Even when he came here for the swearing-in ceremony, the army gave him the permission. Secondly, the problem with Pakistan today is, whatever the leaders may say, you see, there is always a trust deficit. Vajpayee ji went over there, there was Kargil. General Musharraf, he said something else totally in his book, in the line of fire, and now later on he's saying there was something else. There were regular troops over there. I mean, there is too much of trust deficit. Every time they say something, we say, okay, fine, we believe you, but something else happens because of which there have always been impediments. And I would like to ask Brigadier Asif, we both are soldiers. Brigadier Asif, can you hear me? Brigadier Asif?
Well, General Jaiswal, I think we have a problem with the Skype line.
Otherwise,
General Jaiswal, we seem to have a problem with the Skype line with Brigadier Asif Raja joining us from Islamabad. What we'll do is, sir, we'll take a very short break at this point, sort out that issue so that he can come back and we can re-engage. And we'll also try and get through to Padmuja in Ufa. Taking a very short break, do stay with us.